Rick Astley, 30-something and shell suits. BBC Two reliving the 80s on a Saturday night. Here's your man this week.
Hi, I'm Richard E. Grant. Do you remember 1987? '87 was a fantastic year. The year of looking after number one, when greed was good. When you had to know where you were going, the top, what you wanted, everything, and when you wanted it, right now. 1987, the year of me, me, me.
Time, I've made a fortune, and that's what I want. We've gone on holiday by mistake. Love that burns hard enough to last. So when the
night falls, my lonely heart falls. In March 1987, the future of soul music arrived. 12 months later, Terence Trent D'Arby left.
Sweetheart, listen. I know the last few things haven't been good for the both of us.
I was walking down the street, but this guy was in front of me and couldn't have possibly known that I was walking behind him, and I heard him whistling If You Let Me Stay. I thought, whoa, that's not bad, actually, you know. So at that point, I knew I was on the way.
He was outstandingly beautiful.
He's a very tall, very skinny person.
He's got these very long, slim legs.
A bit like a sort of, like an insect.
He danced really well, especially with all the flats sort of flying around.
All the girls that I knew, he didn't have to say If You Let Me Stay. They were just like, hello, Terence, come on in. I should have said it from my heart.
Really thought, oh, he's not going to have that big a voice live, is he? Oh my God, you know, he's sensational.
Good looking, great songs. I mean, he had the world at his feet in 1987.
I had been turned down by every label in England, some of them twice. Wish me love for wishing
well, to kiss and tell. I met Terence's manager, and I always remember the conversation I had with Phil. It was, Phil, forget this one, this is pure trouble.
He's like, don't ever, you know, don't ever foul our doorsteps with this again.
In the 1980s, I was the head of A&R at CBS London.
It was in the process of being turned down by CBS the third time, I believe, before one of those quirks of fate.
And I was wandering down the corridor at CBS, and coming out of the lifts was the most amazing-looking black guy. I said, look, you know, let's stick with him, right? We're going to have to follow this thing through. We struggled for a long time to get him booked onto the Tube.
The Tube then was just such an unmissable weekly event.
Every once in a while, the Tube does something to make everyone happy, and this is it. So you have to put down your baked beans, you have to stand up in your living room, you have to take off your vest because you're going to get so hot, because it's just the best singer you're going to see all year. Don't know much about history. Don't know much
biology. Don't know much about science. Paul used to love to play the femme fatale with any kind of famous lead singers we had on the Tube. But I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love me
too. What a wonderful world this would be.
It was last night, as I dreamt of you, I could only call you baby.
We at the Tube are currently extremely excited about one man. And so for the first time since Paul Young, we're going to have somebody on for 2 weeks running.
She personally booked him back 4 times on the trot afterwards. Don't ask me why. She obviously loved his music.
At one point, you know, I was thinking about getting an apartment, you know, in Newcastle. Because it was like, I seemed like every week I was there.
Get up out of your rocking chair, Grandma! Nobody move! Nobody get away!
From the first few bars of Introducing the Hardline, according to Terence Trent D'Arby, you could tell this was not just another retro soul rehash.
That first album, that's etched in stone. That is one of the best albums of the time.
The Hardline sold nearly 8 million copies worldwide.
The award for the best international newcomer is Terence Trent D'Arby.
Terence Trent D'Arby, born in New York, 25 years old. Tomorrow he's off back to New York, and in March a major US tour begins for him. His album, his debut album, has gone triple platinum. It's less than a year since he was doing showcase gigs in London at Ronnie Scott's Club.
That record was nowhere near as big as the impact that it made. I was quite surprised that it was seen as this huge thing. It really wasn't.
It was quite easy listening music, let's be honest. It was the sort of thing that, you know, music executives played in their BMWs and punched the air quite sadly out of the window at traffic lights.
I was asked by the customs, did I have anything to declare? I said, yes, I'd like to declare that I'm a genius.
It's always a bit of a mistake to proclaim yourself a genius after a first album, I think. It never really goes very well, does it? I mean, you know, even David Bowie or Elvis Presley never did that.
I think Terence got famous and really believed he was a superstar a little too quick, and that's dangerous.
If you asked him to do something one way, he had a tendency to try and do it another way just because he didn't like to be told. You know, he was a real kind of individual.
You get bored and you figure, what can I do today? So you figure, well, I've got a good quote, you know. Why don't I just wind up the press some more? It's quite fun.
There will come a stage, of course, when they'll turn on you.
They haven't done that already?
He was a very, very good media manipulator until, I think, with the British press, he turned around and bit him on the arse.
About a year after the success, things started to change, and if I'm honest with you, I began wishing some of it away.
And I remember he turned up at my house one night with Paul Yates, and he said, I'm on the run from the paparazzi. I said, where have you been? He said, Stringfellas. Now, if you want to avoid the paparazzi, don't go to Stringfellas. So he was playing the game. You know, he thought he could control it, and he was wrong.
I just couldn't enjoy myself more, you know, until it started to just go terribly, terribly wrong.
Sign your name across my heart. I want
The only problem that Terence ever had was he had an abundance of ideas. They were tumbling out, and that sometimes is a worry, because they can't all be good.
My ambition for the future? I'd probably like to do something very, very pretentious.
He was very clear that his next record, no matter what it was, he wanted to be unexpected.
I absolutely loved his first album, and when the second one came out and the reviews were so absolutely dire, I actually didn't want to listen to it because I didn't want to be so disappointed, really.
On his second album, he thought, well, I can do it all myself, and that's the problem. People can start to believe their own hype.
He was sick of what people, including him, had created, this Terence Trent D'Arby monster that had been created. He wanted to take it in a different direction, even if that meant commercial suicide.
himself on a cross, and he's got a little carried away with it. Like, come on, dog. Not the Cross album yet. Who is that guy on the cross? You can't get on the cross and then have people say, who is he? Everybody got to know who that is on the cross.
Know someone deeply.
It sold 300,000 worldwide, which most people were quite happy with. But compared to 9 million for the first album, it wasn't great.
He might have had great talent, but he didn't have the talent he thought he had. You know, it went totally out of control.
Things, when they happen for me, always tend to happen that way. You know, it's either the colossal success or the colossal. But either way, it's colossal, and that just seems to be the way of it.
'87 was his year, and then that was it, really, wasn't it?
But I had a lot of fun. I had the fun you would expect a 25-year-old boy in that environment to have.
But it's still wonderful. I really, really wish that we could have carried on that very first album and everything that he did, but somehow it just hasn't worked.
I don't say this for cover. If the name Terence Trent D'Arby goes on something, I'm feeling it. I'm proud of it, because that name means a lot to me.
He's a great lost talent, and if I was a betting man, I would bet my last tenner that he would come back.
'87, you didn't need to play sport to wear sport. Shell suits brought colour combinations to the high street that had only previously been seen on children's TV.
It became shorthand for everything that was sort of sad and naff and Essex.
The worst item of clothing that has ever been invented.
They were shapeless, they had no style.
It's a bad one. Real bad one.
Shell suits were never, ever, ever cool.
I remember an older, very famous actress advising me when I started in show business to buy a few shell suits because they were marvellous for rehearsals because you can bend and move in them a lot and you just throw them into the washing machine and they're dry straight away. And I remember thinking, I will go to my grave long before I ever wear a shell suit.
Never had a shell suit, no way, never would, no how.
Even though it becomes a fad, as a male, you have to say, I'll pass that one and that one.
You saw them on the street, people sort of slithering along in these terrible bits of parachute.
Who's bad?
I'll show you these friggin'.
My first memory of shell suits was going to Liverpool. I could not believe what I saw.
Around where I was in Liverpool, there were some seriously bad shell suits floating about.
Horrible colours as well. Purple and yellow and orange and green, all on one tracksuit. No.
It was just like flash, flash, colour, colour.
Lots of fun, crazy, bright blues.
Shitty jade green.
The stripes down the side.
Turquoise and jade.
Pink and purple.
Purple, green and orange. Situation
that needs no disguise. You know, if you're out shopping with your mum, you'd leave go with the mum's hand, and if you turned away for a second, suddenly, it was mum, you know what I mean? Because it had just become a wash of colour.
I have seen people wear it with red stilettos and white high heels and glam jewellery. I don't think you should do that.
They've got to be a bit of elastic around the bottom of the shell suit so that the stilettos are at their full glory.
I've never seen shell suits and stilettos, no. But I'm quite willing to pay for it, actually, if anybody fancies it.
The way they worked their way into a family was my mum going, I'll get some of them for going away in.
It's the kind of thing that my mum used to wear to go on holiday. Unfortunately.
But I do still, every now and again, when I'm on an aeroplane or something and I see someone in a shell suit, I do sometimes look at them enviously. I mean, it's not because they match, but because they're sort of baggy and loose.
If you could break them away from the group, and put them back into a normal situation. They would walk along in a normal shop and go, what the hell have I got on? You know what I mean? Quick, quick, burn it, burn it. Give me something to eat.
And if you think that things couldn't get any worse on the sartorial front, remember bum bags.
I went, and I'm not ashamed to admit it, to the Liberace Museum. I just sort of saw this sequin thing for sale and an enormous sticker on it saying fanny pack.
It's quite amusing, that the notion of a fanny pack.
I was absolutely horrified. You're in confusion.
Here's the solution. At the time, you got so used to seeing everybody wearing bum bags.
You'd walk down Oxford Street and there wouldn't be a person not wearing a bum bag.
And now if you see anybody wearing, they look so ugly.
Now I actually wear one when I go out shopping because they're safe.
Initially, the whole point had been to have a little sort of subtle, discreet thing that people didn't notice.
They were crap because you couldn't get anything in them. They were so small, these little zips. Hold on a minute. I think I can get 50p in there.
They started to get bigger and bigger and more ostentatious.
And they just sit there on your front or on your back if you really did want to wear them on your bum, yeah.
I don't need anything that kind of protrudes my ass anyway. Brings attention to my ass.
Q Philip.
Q Sarah.
Cucumber.
Cucumber.
Thanks.
Thanks. Oh, no, just cue anything.
It was perfect Saturday morning viewing. In bed. All right, then. Take me wherever you want to go. It may be childish, but I'm quite happy with that on a Saturday morning.
That's a good start.
It was basically Swap Shop, but without Noel Edmonds, Maggie Filmer, John Craven and Keith Chegwin.
I don't know why Swap Shop was so rubbish and going live was so hip and happening, but it hit it somehow.
Spent a bit of money on set, got some kind of jagged, sharp, kind of 80s style.
Completely compulsive viewing.
It was certainly edgier and a bit funkier than stuff that had happened before.
Hello to Alan Davidson, our friend, who's just got out of jail today for some terrible crimes.
I'll let myself in for it now, but there was something quite sexy at the time, about Philip Schofield.
So everyone was, thought he was really lovely, had a lovely little relationship with Gordon the Gopher, who squeaked and they understood, and he was very funny.
Who is this Gordon? Brian, from where? Your band, the Raucous Rodents.
Philip Schofield was always funniest when something went wrong.
Well, no, you didn't tip it over like that, no?
It's quite hot as well.
Oh, it's just come out of the oven! See this? Running order. Right.
It was controlled chaos.
You can only fill for so long, can't you, really?
There was something with Sarah that I haven't had with any other partner. 3.25 hours on the telly for 6 series. You get to know a person very well by the end of that. And we ended up having this really odd telepathy. I knew what she was going to do. She knew what I was going to do.
She was a terrible flirt.
Pardon?
You know, she flirted with the props if she could. Wait,
come on, your turn. Come on, help yourself.
Distinctly remember getting very over-interested in some item she did in a wetsuit, something like Scunthorpe Baths.
It's just blissful. Will it always be like this, Alex?
I don't really know.
Sarah is a bad girl. She's very naughty.
Like this. I'm very careful holding it on the end of your nose like that, because that's what we always do.
Annabelle Giles has joined us. Good morning.
Hello.
Looking incredibly smart this morning.
Yes.
Annabelle, very sweet, very posh. And very good on the telly.
Well, I used to get letters from people's grandparents saying how nice it was to hear somebody talking decently for a change, because there was far too many regional accents on the television and, frankly, the working classes were creeping in and taking over.
Now, as we shall see, there are millions and hundreds and thousands of them, all very colourful, very bright, in a big, wide range.
I did sort of put some children in some really dreadful spectacle frames on one thing.
I remember at one stage turning around to Sarah and saying, I think it's most important to choose something that suits you.
Yes. And what other words of wisdom do you have, Giles, to drop on us this Saturday morning? Terrible. Didn't have a clue. Quite a snotty cow, I felt.
Frog when a-courting, he did ride a-hum, a-hum.
Trevor and Simon might have been the worst people ever on TV.
Frog when a-courting, he did ride a-hum, a-hum.
All the best. It's a fine line.
You are on one side.
I am on the other.
They were best bit at show, weren't they?
Swing your pants. They were fantastic.
Hello. Hello. Hello, yes, welcome along once again to the pants-swinging extravaganza that has become known as the Singing Corner.
And it started off kind of as a parody of children's television, on children's television.
We just wanted to wear wigs, basically, and funny beards.
Who are you?
My name's Jason.
Oh, David Jason from Only Fools Have Horses.
I think we got Jason Donovan to dress up as a dog, and he ran around the studio with Nigel Kennedy playing Hound Dog on the violin. That was a kind of surreal moment.
But I could always be heard laughing in the background at Trevor and Simon's stuff. They made me laugh so much.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time.
Nigel playing the violin and Jason singing live. It's worth a fortune. Right, I've got to be quick. Shut up! Around about Halloween, they always used to have the witch finders.
Come once more to seek out those that be wicked!
Aye, aye.
And we dress up about 10 kids. The smallest we could get in the studio audience, really small kids. Dress them as mini witch finders.
Come, minions!
Do your best to poke Philip as much as you can, knowing that because they were only short, they'd poke in an obvious area.
Poke him with those sticks!
I'm not a berserker!
Poke him, Philip! Poke the berserker! Wicked!
And I think Philip found that quite, you know, in a perverse way, he enjoyed that as well. Once a year, we got to poke Philip's genitals.
Be off with you! Clear! Clear!
Both me and Simon thought that we were sort of, you know, mature, grown-up, sophisticated adults, and we were just kids. And it's not surprising, really, that sometimes we were really crap.
I hated Gordon the Gopher.
And if you ever wanted to strangle an inanimate object, it was Gordon the Gopher.
We never liked Gordon. He was our rival.
I never was turned on by him.
He was just a sock.
Name was
Gordon. Gordon the Gopher.
What are you saying?
I think Gordon the Gopher was a strange object that someone found in a toy shop that had things knitted for him by old ladies with nothing better to do, in a nutshell.
And there, Gordon, is your little hat. Isn't that super?
Whoever was working him actually had quite a good sense of comedy timing.
Paul Smith spent 10 years under the desk. No one knows him. He's never done any interviews. He never talks to anybody because he's a television executive. And nobody knew that at the time.
And they looked very similar.
I think my worry has always been that doing Gordon the Gopher would overshadow my position in the BBC. And so I used to keep this very quiet. And in fact, it's the first time that I've actually admitted that I did Gordon.
Of course, in the end, if there was a relationship, it was between Philip and Paul Smith's hand, because that was Gordon.
Are we right there, Gordon? That's a good idea, yes?
Gordon was definitely the star of the show. I mean, there was really no doubt about it. But I got used to that.
Before we go any further, would you mind if I just did something for me for a moment? No, come on. Please, just the bit.
Even now, people will say, no. Where's Gordon? How's Gordon? And it doesn't bother me, honestly. Really at all. I'm not fussed by that. But, you know, wherever he is, whatever he's doing, there is no doubt that he'll be stealing someone else's thunder.
In 1987, it was de rigueur to come out of a restaurant hungrier than when he went in. The Emperor's Nouvelle Cuisine.
You got your kiwi fruit.
Sausages fanned out on a plate.
Ballantine of quail's leg.
Lots of chopped up little bits of tomato.
Coolies. I mean, coolies were everywhere.
You got little
scrapes of lime and bits of pineapple
garnished on a salad of rose petals.
A mosaic of garden vegetables set in a chicken mousse.
And it'll be served on this huge 6-foot plate.
Anthony Worrell Thompson, who's now, of course, reinvented as Mr. Ruff, he had a restaurant called Ménage à Trois.
I was very good at doing Nouvelle Cuisine, and especially as my concept was starters and puddings.
I thought, fantastic, prawn cocktail, Black Forest gâteau, what more do you want? Because often those are the nicest bits, bits in the middle, a bit boring.
If you really wanted something to eat, you wouldn't get it from, you know, your Nouvelle Cuisine.
I think Nouvelle Cuisine was chefs, arrogant chefs, taking the piss.
We were screaming gods. I mean, call us what you want. I mean, it was like entering temples of gastronomy.
It's a black hexagonal plate, and the food would be little red splotch there, orange there,
and you couldn't necessarily at first glance tell the difference between any of the courses either.
And they did do funny things around the outside, didn't they? So you'd have your little tiny pile of nonsense in the middle, and then somebody would have sculpted something around the outside, and then occasionally there'd be a little blob there and a blob there, and you thought, oh my God, that's just coloured spit from the kitchens.
I don't see the point in like only covering like 20% of your plate with food. It's kind of quite rude, really, and then charging you a fortune for it. I think somebody was taking the piss with Nouvelle Cuisine.
Surely some mistake here. You've given me the garnish, obviously. Where's the large pie that by law, all meals should contain?
Nouvelle Cuisine just made you want to punch somebody. Do you know what I mean? Just get the cook and go, no, I want to eat food!
It was gross, really. It was sort of rather vomit-making, actually. Because I'm gonna love each and every day.
Bien, naturellement.
Restaurants realised suddenly they could charge an awful lot for giving you water.
I can't remember at what point, you know, I suddenly, you know, switched from thinking it was a ridiculous idea to actually thinking, yeah, that makes sense.
We all do it now, don't we? All tragically. Look in my fridge now and there's, well, what would it to be? Tenant? Or perhaps Highland Spring, guy, you know what I mean? We've all got arrangement now, but then it was just bizarre. You spend money on water, you soft.
And it was, in some way, symbolic of the conspicuous consumption of the 80s, but, you know, we had to find something else to spend money on.
It did kick off another angle of us to make more profit for our restaurants.
This is my recital. I think it's very vital to rock around. That's right. On top.
By 1987, the world had discovered rap, thanks to Run DMC, three hip-hop evangelists from New York.
Run DMC was the bridge to hip-hop going mainstream, was the bridge to people really understanding what hip-hop was.
They were a motivating force in hip-hop, because until a group breaks big, nobody thinks it can be done.
What we did that was different is that we took old records and DJ'd them in order to keep a beat going, and, you know, some of the beats that we would use be rock, some be jazz.
A lot of older people were still in charge, so they wouldn't play rap records on radio, and they wouldn't play rap records on television.
So black people weren't supposed to mess with rock music then. And they did, and made it their own in a really, really cool way.
The band took their fusion of rock and rap to unthinkable extremes when they covered the heavy metal classic Walk This Way. The recording brought them chart success and brought Aerosmith back from the dead.
Steve Tyler, so there's a little hole in the wall, starts singing through the wall, Walk This Way! To walk this way!
I can't remember the rap that went with it, but then there was a rap.
The one thing they didn't have on their side was they weren't white and they weren't middle class, right? So, you know, they were seen in different terms.
Rap, in order to cross over into the white mainstream of America, needed to have a white act that middle class American kids, white kids, college kids could relate to.
And that's tricky.
Who the hell are you?
With the band.
The band? Where's your instruments? What the... Kick it!
Beastie Boys was a punk rock band. They wanted to go into rapping, and we kind of pulled them along with us.
Beastie Boys were one of the greatest groups of the 1980s, without a question. They were vulgar white trash who'd harnessed the sort of energy and the spirit and the attitude of hip-hop.
I mean, the Beastie Boys took hip-hop and had a little humor to it. I'll kick you out of my home if
you don't cut that hair! They helped open hip-hop up to a wider audience. It wasn't just young black kids in urban communities that were into this. It was white kids in the suburbs.
They were like Beavis and Butthead before their time. They were the South Park kids who could rap, basically. And you got, you know, fight for your right to party. You gotta fight for your right to party! I don't care what anyone says, that is up there with the top 10 rock anthems of all time.
When you've had 7 pints of beer and it comes on, you think it's the greatest record ever made, bar none. You gotta fight for your right!
Well, that controversial American band, the Beastie Boys, is being blamed for a curious crime currently sweeping the southeast.
Mike D had a toilet chain around his neck with a Volkswagen sign.
Every single Volkswagen, Beetle or Golf, in this country was denuded of its front badge and even its back badge.
Some fans went to dealers, others found it easier to pinch one.
I didn't take my Volkswagen. I got somebody to take my one. I was always smart enough not to actually do the nicking.
Today's launch by Nottinghamshire police was in an effort to halt what they believe is turning into an epidemic.
It was really scary. Indignant middle-class people all over the country, you know, kind of crying over their VW Golfs every morning.
I had a VW at the time, and it used to drive you mental, because literally every day you'd get a new one, you'd put it on your car, and it would be gone the next morning.
While Britain is bracing itself for the arrival today of an American pop group with a notorious reputation, they're loud, they're obscene, and highly controversial. They call themselves the Beastie Boys.
You've got these two elements coming together when you had Run DMC and the Unholy Marriage of the Beastie Boys touring this country.
When they first booked that concert, the Beastie Boys were like the opening act, and then it would be Run DMC. But by the time the Beastie Boys got here, they were massive. I remember that tour being, you know, this kind of extraordinary media circus. They were trailed by busloads of journalists absolutely everywhere they went.
The vile Beastie Boys are, according to one Tory MP, undesirables and should be banned.
Beastie Boys got the whole nation to believe that they were dangerous and threatening, and they were completely depraved, and they were going to completely subvert the nation's youth.
We're expecting riots when they come to Britain, aren't we? I mean, that is despicable.
Notoriety is important. You've got to have a little bit of liveliness to separate one group from another.
The British press wanted to catch them doing anything, you know, or if they couldn't catch it, they'd make it up.
I think it's a shame that you have to write f***ing articles and make up f***ing lies to sell your f***ing papers. It's really f***ing stupid. She's honest!
Maybe because it was a misunderstood urban music that kind of mobilised loads of kids. They were picking up bad publicity, whatever they did. But she won't run,
'cause she's got that it. Going to Brixton Academy to see those gigs was an unnerving experience. It was kind of like a cross between a football match, a political demonstration, oh, and a little bit of a pop concert thrown in on the side.
It was just one of those gigs that if you weren't there, then you didn't exist.
The Beastie Boys are in the house.
The countdown continues. The beats are rhymes and bass line in beats of Westwood. She's crafting. She gets
around. She's crafting. They went on tour with caged go-go dancers. She's
crafting, and she's just my type. They had a kind of big inflatable penis on the stage. Whoa, that's shocking.
At some point along the way, it would appear they upset the Mirror's reporter, who then wrote a story that at the Montreux Pop Festival, the band members insulted a group of terminally ill children who were attending the pop festival.
These papers are not like real newspapers. They make up anything that they can in order to sell a paper. They don't care. And they made up those stories and they ended up really hurting those kids, which is the worst thing, and the kids feel really bad.
No! Sleep! Down Brooklyn! Oh,
yeah! That incident was directly responsible for the atmosphere at the gig in Liverpool, which ended up with a riot and a court case.
I'm not surprised that something happened up there, you know, because it was brewing that way.
Beastie Boys came on stage and their opening line was, "Yo, Liverpool, you think you're bad, well, we're the Beastie Boys, we're worse than you." And so consequently, they just got bottled, they just got absolutely annihilated.
The record companies and the Beastie Boys must have loved it, because it guaranteed top-of-the-chart sales, sold-out ticket venues, endless T-shirt sales, and lots of wonga.
But it was all cool. I mean, that's what rock stars are supposed to do. Tear shit up.
You gotta fight for your right to party. Get pops, quit your smoking, man. He says, no way.
A pig shat in my head.
The Camberwell carrot.
Get in the back of the van!
We don't want eel, we want rabbit.
These, you know, lines come out of the middle of nowhere. People have shouted out and said, "Scrubbers!" or,
"We've gone on holiday by mistake."
Every now and then someone comes up to you and says,
"Once."
They're usually a bit scared to do it, to be fair, because I'm quite scary. Which is good, you know, because I don't think I'd live with people coming up to me and saying,
"You're looking very beautiful, man. Have you been away?"
It'd be a bit of a worry.
I stand alone, because I don't like with now and I.
"Come on, lads, let's get home. The sky's beginning to bruise. Night must fall, and we shall be forced to camp."
Tell me when the funny things happen, will you? Then I can laugh. The only enjoyment I can see is that great with now and I drinking game, where you have to match them drink for drink.
"I demand to have some booze."
"I have another pair of large scotches." "A pair of quadruple whiskies and another pair of pints, please."
"Two large gins, 2 pints of cider." "Ice and a cider."
"Have another pair of large scotches."
That's a lot of drink. I don't know if anybody's ever managed to get to the end of the film and still be awake.
"You're drunk."
"I've only had a few ales."
The drinking game is for hardcore drinkers only.
I don't drink or smoke, so they gave me herbal cigarettes and semi-diluted Ribena for the wine. Bruce Robinson, who wrote and directed it, forced me at gunpoint to get drunk on the last day before we started shooting. He wanted me to know what it was like to be completely legless. Yeah, I thought I would die. So I passed out and woke up 24 hours later.
We didn't quite get it as much as you get it now, but when it came out, we just thought it was dead cool, and they're just living in that flat and doing drugs and things.
"What do you do with those? The joint I'm about to roll requires a craftsman. It can utilise up to 12 skins. It is called a Camberwell carrot."
"I invented it in Camberwell, and it looks like a carrot. And you can't argue with that."
"Little tend to make you very high."
Basically, Withnail is completely mad. He's an alcoholic tramp. Of course, the irony is, he's a posh public schoolboy who wants to be on the stage.
"Something's got to be done. We can't go on like this. I'm a trained actor reduced to the status of a bum."
In the summer of 1986, I got an audition after being unemployed for 9 months and read this script of Withnail.
"Oh, Christ almighty."
There's one important line where Withnail says, "Fuck it!" And I had that line in my head.
"Fuck it!"
I knew exactly how I wanted that line said, you know. I thought, wow, if he can hit that line, if he can get there without me saying anything, he can probably do the rest.
The scene that Bruce Robinson got very angry about to my face was a tea room scene in the Penrith tea rooms.
If you don't leave, we'll call the police.
Balls. We want the finest wines available to humanity. We want them here and we want them now.
The two lady extras sitting behind me had two pug dogs and they made terrible snuffling sounds. And as soon as I had to talk, all I could hear was sort of... And I thought these women were laughing behind me, and I just went every single time. Like, they never ever got it without me starting to laugh.
We are multi-millionaires. We shall buy this place and fire you immediately. Yes, we'll buy this place, and we'll install a jukebox in here. Liven all you stiffs up a bit.
Now, he did 15 takes, he laughed on every single take. And in the end, they were forced to keep it in, you know.
Well, when you try to give a plot summary of With Nail and I, it always sounds really rubbish because not a lot happens, really.
It's two scraggy blokes living in a squat in Camden Town.
I think we've been in here too long. I feel unusual. I think we should go outside.
They go on a disastrous country weekend to the gay uncle's cottage.
They don't know anything about surviving in the countryside. They're real wimps.
Are you the farmer?
Stop saying that, Whitnell! Of course he's a farmer!
Me and the farmer get on fine. Through stormy weather and bars of wine. If I pull my way...
I can make it die.
When they are threatened, they just completely bottle it.
I've been watching you, especially you, prancing like a tit. You want working on, boy.
You want working on, boy.
It's just that one line seems to stick.
Monty was a big old bunty. Because Richard Griffiths is a very funny and endearing man.
So you're a thespian too?
There's a sleazy, predatory, dislikable aspect of what that character could have been was completely avoided.
I brought two of these in case either of you was any good in the kitchen.
I'm not.
With Nail has told Uncle Monty that I is gay.
Can't find the grocery. Sure we could find it together.
As he turns up in the full rig, a dressing gown and a pile of makeup in the middle of the night.
I had to come. I tried not to. Oh, how I tried not to.
Sir Monty, something I have to explain to you.
You needn't explain. He's told me everything.
And Uncle Monty says, you know, I shall take you by burglary if I have to. You know, he's just going to fall. He's going to crush the guy.
I mean to have you even if it must be burglary.
Where With Nail stands head and shoulders above most other films is the script, is the wit of the script, and is the fact that they make this movie a classic about doing nothing.
I just think it's a piece of magic.
Chin chin.
And so it seems most of the youth culture now.
It was a very low budget film, so you don't even begin to think that it might go on to have some kind of cult status.
I think it's now a bit more than a cult. I think it's now an acknowledged classic, which is rather great. You know, it joins the pantheon of classics like Carry On Up the Khyber.
Harp to sharp. Mate to... Mate? I thought you had a way with tight again here. Head
to head.
Could I have another one, please? Date? To date. Bet that head you're worried. Sharp to harp. Get sharp to harp.
It must have been the equivalent of having a Pikachu Pokemon now. No, because everyone just had to have one.
Suddenly everybody's got a head bag, apart from me. I didn't have one.
The girls had the smaller one, and guys had this huge bag, which was almost like a canoe.
You couldn't go to a gym or go football without someone pulling out a smelly pair of football boots out of a head bag.
Yeah, I don't know where this head thing came from, but again, you know, when you came back from your holidays, head bags were going all around the carousels, especially, I think it was more of a northern thing, especially in Manchester.
I think I've been at Heathrow probably four or five times, where virtually every other bag was a head bag.
You could get everything in there, a small child,
and a car, caravan. It was the Mary Poppins bag.
She had to carry this log-shaped object, this leather log.
The first one was about 26, 27 inches, which was slightly bigger than the other ones on the market.
You'd always get the logo peeling off, so sometimes it would say Ed.
Head written on it in a somewhat ill-advised, provocative way.
There's always arguments about what does the wishbone symbol stand for. Is it a wishbone of a chicken, or is it the point of a ski? I tend to think it's a point of a ski, because obviously Head originally was a ski company.
Yeah, it was some blowjob innuendo, and it was great. The guy who made this was thinking, great, I've got, 6 million kids around the world all carrying bags with a blowjob on it.
Network 7 was created by
Janet Street Poulter, and it was the first of my youth programmes.
It was like a mutant, hideously twisted, scarred version of Richard and Judy. Which goes out around the same time slot, for the same length of time, is live, but they're never hung over. We don't think.
It was the first youth programme which attempted not to be worthy or dull.
It was always the God slot, morning worship and all that. So it was a very clever idea to open that up to this kind of young, upwardly mobile, aspirational TV.
I used to watch it just sitting in my room, having got up from a very late night on the town.
Basically, it woke you up with a jolt.
Wake up!
They were excruciatingly fashionable, the Network 7 team, and also spectacularly stuck up.
I would be sitting in my caravan, and as my time approached, I would look across and I would see the camera, coming towards me faster and faster and faster and faster, and the floor manager would be counting down, and this just terror would rise inside my body. And actually, even now, when I hear the theme tune to Network 7, it still makes me feel physically sick.
Magenta was the sort of party-going, gossip-mad, crazy person who always hung around at parties.
My name's Magenta. This is my pink gossip caravan. I think I'm going to call it Fifi. And this is where all the really hot stuff on the show happens, believe me.
And she was so splendidly rude in such a funny way.
What's actually happened to you is that you've become famous, really, for being famous. I mean, so far, you haven't achieved anything yet.
I haven't done much, but that's what I've got to work at now.
Network 7.
Network 7.
Network 7.
It sounds very James Bond.
It was a madhouse of inexperience. We all turned up at this amazing place, which was really like a warehouse in Docklands, and our job was basically to make a programme and produce it, and we hadn't had any experience at all.
There was me, sort of thinking, well, this is the jolly television adventure, and I'm sure somebody knows what they're doing.
Now, that is a rather boring, ordinary piece of plastic, and because we don't have ordinary, boring things on Network 7, this is what we'll do with it. Off it goes.
Most people remember, I think it was the first episode where they showed a bloke who was doing credit card fraud and showed how easy you could get money out of a hole-in-the-wall machine. I remember being absolutely stunned by that.
What we're going to do now is the first on British television. This is the first computer mugging.
Complete scandal. I mean, the building societies and banks were absolutely furious.
And now this money, which is not my money, here we are. One, two...
The intention of the item was basically to show that banks could defraud you.
But of course what we were doing was blatant fraud. No one told us this. We were all completely vulnerable to being prosecuted by the banks.
Ladies and gentlemen, the dream we all dream of.
They put captions on with information over people talking, and you can't both listen to what they're saying and read the captions at the same time. I found that a bit. And some of the captions were on so briefly, you never even got to the end of the.
I've never seen such a pretty girl look so tough, baby.
The death row item undoubtedly caused a lot of controversy.
I'm here in Louisiana's death row with Ed Byrne, who's scheduled to go to the electric chair in just 2 weeks.
If you look back at it today, it seems kind of ludicrously camp in some ways, the sort of live bit in the studio. Various rather unpleasant methods of death basically being lined up item by item.
Two charges of 2,400 volts are sent through his body, followed by muscle-paralysing liquid.
But in a sense, it was a very dramatic item at the same time and making a serious point. And I think, you know, we couldn't have made the serious point in any other way.
Roger, 1202, we copy it.
Network 7 was like kind of raw television, man. Raw, stripped down, no bullshit, straight to the point.
I think we really delivered, and I think we were doing things journalistically, which nobody else was doing at the time.
Did we ever court controversy? I mean, that was the point. It wasn't worth doing unless you were going to be talked about.
Suddenly you would have rather serious documentary programmes having to have interesting things to look at. You think, where did that come from? Well, it came from programmes like Network 7, whether you like it or not. Shit.
1987, there was a new fashion which begged the question, does my bum look big in this? To which the answer was always, oh yes.
It went out and then came into the knee and went very tight around the knee.
Over and round and up and down again.
Remember Lynn Frank's wearing one and me screaming to take it off?
They looked like toilet roll holders. They look like those crinoline ladies that people have in their toilets. You thought if you shoved your hand up that skirt, you could pull out a roll of Andrex. Puffball skirts? When, where? Why? Who?
How did it stay out there? There was no volume, you know, it had to have some kind of little kind of puffs of fabric going on, you know, within it. That's why it was called a puffball skirt.
The fashion industry has over the years found many, many ways of expressing their misogyny, but none tops the puffball skirt. That skirt says, I hate women. Whoever designed that, I hate women.
Yeah, I'm sure it was Vivienne Westwood that designed the first puffball.
I did this little tiny miniature crinoline, which actually emphasised the hips. And that crinoline could be worn as an outer garment on its own because it had little bones in it. And sometimes I put fabric over it, rather puffy, so you'll see what I'm saying, because it was eventually copied and called a puffball or something.
Vivienne did one, Lacroix did the biggest, it was out here and about $1 million. It just is hard to say why it looks right at the time, but it just was.
Proof was made in a period of nightclubbing and a lot of parties, a lot of social dinners everywhere. So it was not for going to the office for sure. It was like in everything in the 80s, it was something very quick, something which was not made for lasting.
I must admit, I did feel a slight contempt for the intelligence of any women who bought it, really, because you thought, just look at the models wearing it. They're models. They're really beautiful. And they don't look very good. In fact, they look like dozy mares in this awful, awful skirt. How do you think you're going to look then?
Princess of Wales probably looked absolutely marvellous in hers. But anybody who was, you know, built quite normally in a pretty British type of way with, you know, chubby thighs that rub together on a hot day, you just really wouldn't want to go there at all.
Used to wear the puffer with the stripy tights. Like, really horrible. Really, really nasty. Just like horizontal black and white stripy tights with the black puffball skirt. And I actually wore that. What you doing?
Hey, I took it home from Topshop. I was really pleased with it. And I got it in, I got it home to my bedroom. Best friend came along and just went, you are not going out like that.
A lot of people were wearing puffball skirts with knee-length socks that they'd bought from Boy on the King's Road, and I couldn't really afford to shop at Boy on the King's Road, so I just thought, well, I'll just get a pair of my dad's socks and just wear them up to the knee. And so I just made it even worse. I mean, grotesque puffball skirt, disgusting knees, and then these awful kind of dad socks just hoiked up.
It was a really, really, really deeply unflattering look. Mine came to mid-calf, which was triply unflattering. Truly appalling.
Puffball skirt, never wore it out, I don't think. I think I actually put it on, my dad laughed. And he never does that, he's a very supportive man, but I realised then,
Maybe not.
A Filofax, a pinstripe suit, a pair of red braces, and a phone the size of a brick. Young urban professionals had it all in 87, except, of course, lunch.
Lunch? Oh, you gotta be kidding. Lunch is for wimps.
How do you do, Mr. Gecko? Bud Fox.
From the director of Platoon, Wall Street.
Charlie Sheen is the young, ambitious stockbroker who cheats and lies in his way to the top at Gordon Gekko's behest.
Something big is going down. I want to know where he goes and what he sees. I want you, pal, to fill out the missing picture.
Mr. Gecko, that's not exactly what I do.
Well, you can trade your honor.
I could lose my license. That's inside information.
For power.
I think that Wall Street clearly said, if you want to go this route, fine. It's available, but it's going to cost you far more than you think you can afford.
What about hard work?
What about it? You work hard, but you stayed up all night analyzing that dog shit stock you gave me, huh? Where'd it get you? My father, he worked like an elephant pushing electrical supplies till he dropped dead at 49 with a heart attack and tax bills. Wake up, will you, pal? If you're not inside, you are outside, okay?
Michael Douglas playing Gordon Gekko, this shark-like Wall Street trader, entrepreneur. And he said, greed is good.
The new law of evolution in corporate America seems to be survival of the unfittest. Well, in my book, you either do it right or you get eliminated.
Gordon Gekko represented something which basically was clearly around in sort of Reagan's America and Thatcher's Britain, this idea of greed being good.
Greed is right. Greed works.
And he gives a very convincing argument. I mean, it's almost like a Mrs. Thatcher rallying speech, because I can imagine Mrs. Thatcher saying greed is good. It's exactly the kind of thing she would say.
Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit.
I definitely remember thinking, like, Gordon Gekko, okay, he's slightly cool, guilty, you know, in a guilty way.
America took this man as a hero, and greed is good was used quite seriously to justify what went on.
Greed, for lack of a better word, is good.
I think Oliver Stone possibly expecting us all to be a little bit more sensitive than we were. People watched that film, I watched that film and thought, Gekko is cool, I want to be Gekko. Don't care that he's horrible, I want to be him, end of story.
Fine, you don't want to stay with the scum and present management dedicated to running you and your airline into the ground.
That scum built the company up with one plane in 30 years and made something out of nothing. If that's a scum, I'll take it over a rat any day. You know where I stand. Good night, all.
The story of the father-son relationship, Charlie Sheen and his father, who is actually played by Martin Sheen in this movie, that pervades the whole story.
As far as being axed, I'm still around, and as long as I am, I have a responsibility to the union membership I represent.
Your responsibility, Dad, is to present the facts, not your opinions to your men.
My dad was a factory worker for 47 years. He worked all his life for a decent living, and he cherished honesty. He was scrupulously honest. If you cheated, you lost my father's respect in an instant.
When my men come to me tomorrow morning wanting to know what the hell's going on, I'll be damned if I'm gonna like.
That's the character you see in Wall Street, is my father, you know, centered, sees the villain real clear, you know, warns the lad, you know, this is coming down. This guy is not your friend.
I don't go to sleep with no whore, and I don't wake up with no whore. That's how I live with myself. I don't know how you do it. I hope I'm wrong about this guy. But I'll let the men decide for themselves. That much I promise you.
The loss of one soul is done in increments. If it were done in a flash, if it were done overnight, it would be easy to detect, but it's not. As I say, you don't know that it's already happened.
Towards the end, basically, the teacher has been done over by the pupil.
I taught you how to get information, how to use it. That's terrible, isn't it? I can't do impression.
I showed you how the system works, the value of information, how to get it.
What does he do? He punches him.
You cockroach!
Because that's all he's got left.
I gave you your manhood, I gave you everything!
I think that's what it's really about. Actually, it's all rubbish that he talks. It's all show. Actually, he's just a hard guy who wants to grind the other person down into the ground.
I'm just Bud Fox.
As much as I wanted to be Gordon Gekko, I'll always be Bud Fox.
I liked the movie because I hated yuppies and that whole scene so much in the 80s that it was a perfect movie for me because they all get their comeuppance in it.
Buy, buy, buy. Sell, sell, sell. They were utterly mobile and under your skin.
Can't stand them myself.
They were contemptuous, arrogant. Let's go to work. We're focused. We're in the zone.
So obnoxious and hateful.
We can do this. It's the 80s. It's achievable. We can make it happen.
Trying to get ahead and make money and your... The entire world, yuppie world, was just making money world.
2.5 at 4, 2.5. Nothing wrong with being a yuppie. That's nothing wrong with being young and wanting it and trying to create a perfect life. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Young, urban, professional.
I don't know, Pratt or something. It was weird. They were really, really dreadful people.
The point about a yuppie was the way a yuppie worked a room, the way a yuppie networked, the way that a yuppie thought about him or herself as a sort of little economy of one, me PLC. That was the important thing about yuppies.
Stock market will be a car park in 5 years' time. I'll have made a fortune, and that's what I want.
You think you're better than media. What have you got that I haven't? You know, it's like car, a house, regular income, teeth. These are caps.
The marvellous thing about the whole yuppie movement was it was the only public, visible lapse of social morality that came with accessories.
Actually, I've got a mobile phone.
And nobody thought they'd take off. It shows you, didn't it?
Smaller high-frequency transmitters means that you can have smaller telephones.
The Motorola, which was about that big, with an aerial like that, and it cost £1,400.
I said, oh, can I ring my mum? It's fantastic. I want one of these.
And you went around with this thing clamped to your ear, and it was a badge of rank. You were very, very important if you had one of these phones.
Amazingly huge. And when you look back, it was just... We thought it was the most fantastic thing to be able to ring somebody like that.
Yes, I'm just doing nothing.
When you're talking accessories, you are talking the F word, you're talking file effects.
What was there before the file effects? Let's be honest, there was like the Collins Scouting Diary. The horrible little skinny things with that wee gold edged bit.
Very tempting to go out and buy the extra accessories that can cost, wait for it, from 99 pence to £9, which is an awful lot of money.
Where to get a beer in London? Where to get a beer in Manchester? Answer, go to a bloody pub. But no, you actually have an insert, because that ran your life.
Where would I be without my street map of Kuala Lumpur?
Maps of islands off the west coast of Thailand.
Underground maps of Tokyo or something. Things you were just absolutely never going to use.
And again, the ruler holder.
And he thought, what am I going to do with that ruler? Am I going to underline something impending? And then he thought, no, I must just get a life.
You can't really blame the excesses and the greedy nastiness that went on in the 80s on the Filofax, really. It was an innocent bystander.
The 80s might have been a decadent decade, but being young, rich, successful and having everything you ever wanted wasn't easy. In 1987, Yuppie Angst got its own TV show.
Even in the opening titles, it kind of calmed you down a bit. It did just start selling you this lovely lifestyle.
30-something, even now, my pulse is racing.
30-something in lower caps suddenly became an actual word that people people would use, both derogatorily and complimentarily.
I was such a fan of 30-something, and it was one of those things I knew that I probably shouldn't have been.
It was all about getting married and growing up.
I loved 30-something. I mean, I lived for 30-something.
You either just loved it passionately or...
Hated it. Hated it.
Or you wanted all of us just dragged out into the middle of town and beaten.
The
the names Hope and Michael, I mean, just those names are so sort of resonant.
There was Michael in advertising, very ethically bothered about it. Didn't think it was a good thing to be in.
Hi, honey.
I probably thought about Michael from time to time.
Uh-oh.
I was convinced that the way to hold your marriage down was to be able to fold a fluffy towel. Because whenever Michael came home to Hope, she was folding fluffy white towels.
And you just knew that Hope had a linen cupboard that probably had sprigs of lavender interspersed between the pillowcases, which would be Egyptian cotton.
When I was writing This Life, I thought there must be this kind of central relationship that the other characters circulate around. And I designed Millie and Egg to be that kind of central relationship. Elliot was kind of slightly messy and slightly wet.
Elliot cheated on his wife and left his wife and then came back and couldn't decide what he wanted. And, you know, he was all over the place.
Most guys were going, "Eh, what are you doing? You know what I mean? You're blowing. I can't get away. My wife's now looking at me saying, you're just like Elliot."
Who was the one with the straggly hair who looked a bit like Bjorn Borg?
Oh, yes!
Gary's the Bjorn Borg look-like character.
Gary, yes, long hair. He always knew he was trouble but didn't mean to be.
He was kind of part professor and part hobo, you know? He wanted to be able to still be a kid, but yet the demands of his life were becoming an adult.
What's the bottom line here? The business goes under and we lose our houses. Which in my case is no big deal since I hate my house. And in your case, serves you right for getting a nice house to begin with.
To have a television show come on that talked about the things that you thought you were the only one who felt them that way, you know, it sort of made people feel they belonged to a group again.
Hey, if you, you know, need the stage, take the stage. Mike, it's only business.
You go to their friends and say, "Did you see the show the other night? Have you ever felt that way?" Well, yeah, I kind of have too.
Never used to worry about business, remember? No possessions, no encumbrances. Thanks for your help, Gear. Hey, I have a right to viciously attack your values. That's what friends are for.
There was an element about 30-something, it has to be admitted, that was a tad maudlin.
The shows did get bleaker as the show went on.
If you die, will you go to heaven?
When we decided to give Nancy cancer, there were huge arguments among the staff as to whether she should die or not.
I'm not gonna die. But if you did, would you go to heaven?
I hope so.
And Nancy, I remember wearing a scarf for an awfully long time, which I think meant that her cancer went on and on and on. But I quite like that, though, you see. I like things that look great but are a bit bleak underneath.
We went around and around and around trying to decide whether Nancy should live or die. You begin to feel like the strange god, you know, over these characters, and you don't really want that power.
It's good news, Elliot. It's the best possible news. I just had to get up. I had to get up and look out and just see. I mean, there's lights and there's the ice and it's sparkling and everything is shiny. It's just a parking lot, isn't it?
To preserve everybody and keep everybody intact at the end of Nancy's storyline would have been too TV safe for these guys.
We decided that the existentially interesting thing to do would be to have somebody else die.
Gary's death. You know, I think they just had to kill somebody.
Gary's dead.
Not funny.
No, nope. I had a message from a police officer, and
Michael.
Yeah, he wants me. Oh, Hope, I have to go to a hospital. I have to go to another hospital. They want me to.
No.
I remember being in the body bag inside the morgue drawer and, like, lying in there waiting for them to roll action. Thinking to myself, my God, I'm in a body bag witnessing my own death. It's like, how many people go through this experience? You know how you realize things in your head, but then when they happen, suddenly all the cells in your body realize it? And it was sort of that experience for all of us. It was like, oh my God, one of us, one of the group is gone.
I think we were interested in grabbing the audience by the throat and shaking the audience. There was some aggressiveness to how we saw our role as filmmakers. We wanted to make people cry. We wanted to upset them.
Oh, okay. Okay, shh, okay.
I was sitting next to someone and she was very, very upset. She was very distraught and I was incredibly happy. This woman was miserable. I was responsible and I was very pleased. And finally during a commercial, she said, "Oh, I'm so sorry Gary's dead." And I said, "Really, really, why? Why are you so upset?" And she said, "'Cause he looks so cute in jeans."
This is gonna sound sort of very Mary Shirley MacLaine-ish. But I think that the planet wanted that show.
I worry a bit about those actors and wonder what they're doing now. And, you know, where are Hope and Michael? What are they doing? I hope they're all right.
Well, we're all going to end up at the conventions, aren't we, where people come dressed up as the characters. That's going to be kind of sad.
Oh, I loved it. I wish they were doing it now. There's nothing on anymore.
When I was a small boy, pups were for PE in the school hall. In 1987, pumps had become trainers and essential footwear.
£70 for a pair of trainers, your mum and dad were just like, "This is ridiculous, everything's, you know, everything's going mad."
Your shoes were more expensive than everything else you were wearing.
You'd do anything to get those sneakers.
Used to try and get a friend to work in Olympus who could do you a favour.
You'd ask your mum, you'd ask your grandparents, you'd take a paper job, you'd do anything.
I don't need to tell you anymore, but that is what, that was the only option you had.
There was a thing called Stepsies, where if you had a new pair of sneakers, kids would like step on your sneakers so they won't look brand new. In the 80s, that changed though.
What happens if I tread on your sneakers then? What happened? Well, I would expect you to apologize.
You saw kids wearing sneakers fresh out the box, fly, clean.
My mum was more of the kind of Marks and Spencer kind of shopper.
You don't want Nikes, you don't want Reeboks, get a pair of Dunlops.
I was in Dunlop Green Flash.
Yes! Do it. Do it. And you're like, "Ma, I can't wear that." You know what I mean? Look, what is, you know, it's like, it's a no-name reject brand.
Get it. I still don't quite get it. Do you get it?
It's all about secret codes to people to say I'm in.
Adidas.
Adidas tennis. We go go in these. This one we go go in.
If you'd sort of like been lucky enough to go to New York and got them in a different colour to everybody else, you know, definitely you'd be wearing them on the bus and people would be checking them out.
Run DMC are in the house.
Run DMC!
Run would come out in total darkness. And he'd go, "Before I get this show started, I need some lights." And like, "Before I get this show started, I need my DJ." "But to really get this show started, I need my Adidas." You might think Adidas would rule because Run DMC took it to the next level.
Once that record came out, you had to have a pair of Adidas trainers.
I bought many pairs of shell tops because Run DMC had them. You kind of hold them up and you'd want to wear them without laces because Run DMC wore them like that.
For ages then, it was obviously more hip in the hip-hop community to wear Adidas than Nike. Nike was more aligned with the sportswear stars, Jordan, things like that, and Adidas went more street.
Nike came along and they were big, pumped-up American trainers.
In Europe and the world, it was Adidas. In America, with the money and the output, it was Nike. So there was a wonderful competition between the two.
You used to always have to be Nike Air trainers.
A lot of people wore Jordans from day one.
The best player of the most beautiful game, probably outside of football, wearing these beautiful shoes.
They were like the holy grail.
It's like there's a wake behind you of Air Jordan-ness.
What's happened now is that it's not just a street thing anymore. My mum wears a pair of Nike Cortez, and she gets upset if we've scuffed them. You know, this isn't right.
So you've fallen in love with your next-door neighbour, but your dad doesn't think he's good enough for you, so run away. That's what Damon and Debbie did back in 1987.
Never lay a finger on her again. Oh!
Stop it! Brookie looked real.
Well, I gave you a thumping, did I? You don't know what a thumping is, girl!
The things that we were talking about, you know, like unemployment and domestic violence, all those kind of issues were suddenly in your face in a soap opera.
People did used to genuinely mock soaps. Now we all accept that they are well-acted, running dramas. Some good actors, some bad actors, some great actors. Simon O'Brien, as Damien, a great actor.
Why did you tell him?
I was scared. I'm scared now.
Once, just once I hit you. What else did you tell him? Did you tell him I went to a night school so I could help you with your homework? Did you tell him that? No, I bet you didn't.
Damon, I think, was a great symbol of you know, that lost generation, Maggie's children, not really going anywhere and with no direction at all.
The old men don't stay in and smack you for nothing.
He likes hitting people. He hit Debbie yesterday.
Oh, I see. So you thought you'd go down and take a poke at him, is that it?
No!
And then, of course, he met Debbie and fell in love with Debbie.
I mean, for Damon, Debbie opened up a completely different world that he'd never seen, never experienced before, you know.
It's funny, innit? Came round there this morning to make sure you didn't finish with me. Ended up making sure you did.
I haven't finished with you.
I was hoping you'd say that.
Debbie was sort of going to university and doing A-levels, and him, he you know, he'd left at 16 and he was trying to get a job and he couldn't get a job.
She wasn't that middle class. You know, she wasn't middle England. But in terms of Scousology, Scally Scousology, she was quite a few rungs up.
And there's this inherent suspicion of the family that both weren't good for each other.
Just because I went away, it wouldn't mean we'd lose touch. Not if you came with me.
And so they eloped, basically.
And they did this fantastic experiment, and they called it a soap bubble.
Damon and Debbie, the first soap bubble.
No one had really thought of doing this before, taking two characters from a soap, which you know already know from your research are popular, and focusing on them.
Aren't they brilliant?
Everything's brilliant.
My daughter's missing, she could be anywhere.
I've run away from home and now I'm playing house with my boyfriend on someone's boat.
Debbie.
Why should I talk to you about it?
Please, Debbie.
Get off!
Debbie!
I think it was one of the first pieces ever of guerrilla TV that was ever made. He made it up literally as we were going along.
Damon!
Damon!
Kevin.
Damon!
Because it was going out at a different time slot, a different length, you could say to Frank Boyce, who wrote the script, just fly a bit.
I seen her with a needle. She's a smackhead.
Damon! I'm a diabetic.
Gilly was incredibly naive at the time she wrote Mammy Satan. She was incredibly naive. I wouldn't be surprised, and I bet she'd never admit it, but I wouldn't be surprised if the kiss of Damon and Debbie wasn't Jill's first kiss as well.
Who told you that? Yes, it was. I just pretended that I'd done it before. So you didn't know, I don't think. You probably did.
They ended up staying on a lovely barge on the river and this kind of stuff by chance, and everyone thought, oh, it's all going to end up happily, you know.
He dies tonight. Watch Damon and Debbie, he dies tonight.
The ending was tragic, with a capital T, and random, and quite shocking, and quite real.
He gets stabbed. He dies tonight. Watch it.
Simon O'Brien came to me at the normal round of contracts and just said that he wanted to move on.
Someone on it.
I figured the best way to drive myself forward was to burn me bridges, and so I suggested to Phil, let's kill the character.
Which I always think is really brave, you know, especially considering his age.
It's blood. She covered in blood.
So I just said, OK, fine, we'll do it.
You're cold inside.
Hang on.
Oh, no, come on.
It can't be anything serious. I feel all right.
Your last scene being your death, a bit of a challenge for you there to finish off on, lad. At the same time, you know, I've got this excitement inside me as well, so you're filming this incredibly sad scene, and what I actually want to do is go, ooh, I've finished, see you all later. I've had this kind of this battle going on inside me.
I'll just lie here. I just drift.
He'd grown up, don't forget, on screen. You know, the viewers had followed his career, and we snuffed him out. We killed him. How could you do that? You know, even now, it was, how could you have done that?
Damon, talk to me.
I didn't need any tears. I was just started to cry and I didn't stop.
People were coming up to me afterwards and saying, how dare you, my daughter's distraught, you know, our family isn't the same now, things aren't right. There were wreaths left on my doorstep.
An awful lot of 20-year-old girls know where they were in the world when Damon died.
People absolutely take it in, hook, line and sinker, and I just didn't know this until Damon's death.
To a lot of people watching the show, it was a shock. But, you know, that's what drama's about.
Be not afraid of greatness. Some men are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. In 1987, Rick Astley had greatness thrust upon him.
I always remember thinking to myself, my God, people are going to die when they see Rick Astley.
OK, you take a combination of Mutant Willows, also Stock, Aitken and Waterman, and a guy called Rick Astley in a song called Never Gonna Give You Up, and you have a hit. Have a look at this. First time on Top of the Pops. It's superb.
I think I remember hearing the record and thinking, that's a great new soul singer.
Certainly everybody thought he was black.
It was very difficult to suspend your disbelief when you actually saw him in the flesh on Top of the Pops, because you thought, this boy looks like an accountant. We're no strangers to love. You know the rules, and so do I. People suspected at first that Rick Astley wasn't for real, you know, that it was actually some old soul geezer from America, and they just kind of picked this office boy to come and front it. I just
wanna tell you how I'm feeling. And he sang from right there, the back of his throat, didn't he?
Never gonna give you up. Never gonna let you down.
Never gonna run around. Not only did his voice attract me, but his movement. This little funny dance he did. And it reminded me of when I saw Van Morrison in about 65. It was the same shock to the system as like this amazing voice and this silly little dance.
He didn't have dancing lessons. He didn't even know he was doing that sort of little dance that he used to do that everybody thought wanted to copy.
It's probably unfair, but I remember him being the most appalling dancer I'd ever seen on a television screen. Don't tell me you're
too blind to see. Along came Rick, and suddenly it was okay to stand there with your feet firmly planted as if super glued to the spot and just occasionally, you know, try and do something with your upper body.
Rick appealed to the biggest audience on the face of the earth, middle of the road.
Ladies and gentlemen, 1987 was an incredible year for our next artist.
He's the top-selling singles artist of the year, and this is the best-selling record of the year.
I mean, he sold 15.5 million. People forget how big Rick Astley was.
Here is Rick Astley!
He was the closest we've ever come to Frank Sinatra.
Whenever I need somebody, I'll bring my love to you. You don't have to say you love me. I just want to be with you.
He could never get a suit that fit him, though, could he? He obviously never got measured for them. They were just kind of, you know, off the peg. I'd pop into Topshop on my way to Top of the Pops and pick up this suit.
I think when we did Top of the Pops, I gave him 300 quid. He went down to the next in Warrington and bought his suit. She wants to dance with me, 'cause I hold her so tight next to me. She wants to dance with me.
In only the last 6 months, Rick Astley has progressed from club singer to become the hottest property in pop.
He's had three successive number ones in Europe and a chart-topping album.
I am slightly trying to progress myself a little more because obviously that's something that I want to do. I do like the idea of perhaps writing an album completely myself at some point and maybe even producing it all as well, but I think you've got to take things a step at a time, you know.
It was in the press that Rick didn't want to be a Stock Aitken Waterman puppet.
And I'm sure it's no secret anymore, there were certain tracks that was released that he personally would rather he hadn't done.
When I fall in love, it will be forever.
It just so happened that Christmas came along and record companies being what they are and everything, and so they decided to release it as a single. That was not the intention, believe me, but there you go.
He wanted to do other things, which he talked to Pete about at the time, about moving it slightly from what they were doing then to something else. And of course, when that didn't happen, that then brought us to a bit of an impasse and something had to go.
Cry for help. Please release me from a record deal. Rick Astley's got a new song, it's really good, dead different.
I wandered around the streets of this town.
The minute that I was told he didn't want to record with me anymore, boom. I said to my lawyers, go and do the deal, give him his contract back. It didn't worry me, because I always said to Rick, I'd rather be his friend than his record company.
Pete did have a deep feeling about him, and when it all went sour, if you like, it did upset him. And I think even now, if I sit and talk to Pete about it, I can see it upsets him.
All that I need is to cry, oh hell. Somebody please hear me cry, oh hell.
I consider myself to be a quiet person, so being in the public eye, the spotlight, or whatever you want to call it, isn't typically me.
I think you tend to value the simple things in life, Wolf. Suddenly, Sunday lunch, you know, Sunday dinner in front of the TV, you know, Wolf. All that suddenly becomes really important, you know.
People used to say to me, oh, I bet you're really happy Rick Astley's failed. I went, no. Why? Why would I want Rick Astley to fail? I would have loved Rick Astley to go on from me, which he did. He did Cry for Help, which was fantastic. I would have loved him to go on and become what I thought he could be.
Why can't we ever break down and cry?
Rick eventually decided that he needed a break from the music business.
Some people just aren't cut out for fame and stardom, and I don't think he persisted with it because I don't think he wanted it.
And I'm glad he didn't do it in the end, you know, because obviously he'd had enough of that at that point.
All that I need is to cry for help.
A lot of blokes that night who went home and tearfully folded up the chinos, put away the blazers, and knew that there was a new era coming.
...1987. The films, the fashion, the music, the TV, it was all a blur to me. I hope you remembered it. And if you like being scared to death, stick around for our 87 movie next. The Evil Dead are back.
Next week, it's 1988.
Are you ready, Warrington? I want a big cheer! On my nighttime job.
Turtle power!
Pizza, pizza, pizza!
Enough with the comedy.
Acid House. Why stop the party?
Excellent!
It's a solo version of a high five.
She was just out the blocks, upright, and gone.
You and me now.
Test your knowledge of 80s music on the Pop Master Quiz with Ken Bruce, weekday mornings from 9:30 on 88 to 91 FM, BBC Radio 2.